You know, it happened after that many works that belong now to this network portraits, but it didn't start it from the idea that I want to make this series, or that there is a urge to make a portrait of the network or of myself. But there is a situation that there are works of mine that are about the internet and also about me. And even if they are not about me personally, the figure of me is there, and this is how it becomes a portrait. But this, you know, this ambiguity that is in the title of this series now, it's on purpose there. Mm. So it's like, it's about myself, but also about me being online for many long time already, and about how things are changing online, and also trying to catch this picture or the portrait of many people who are actually creating their internet and the World Wide Web by being there. So it's portrait of other users, and it's also the how I do picture the network and how I want it to show to others. That some things that are invisible, that they would become visible. Long tradition of net art that you work with what you have. And you yourself is the easiest, the cheapest, the most available, the one that shows most understanding. So that's why you can so often see net artists themselves in their own projects. Maybe it could be somebody else. Maybe in my next portrait there will be finally somebody else, but I hope that internet will be still there, or especially that the World Wide Web will be still there. And I always make this difference because I think that it's actually very sad and dangerous that we forget what's the difference and that we just talk about some digital things or some online things, about some technology, and don't see that there is a World Wide Web, and the World Wide Web is made by people, and it's always their effort, what they produce and how they also connect to each other. And you just mentioned that it's about other people, and this is, for example, the summer that is now the first network portrait, and it is 25 people. I'm very grateful because they keep me, file of me, picture of me on their server, and they link to each other, and they take care that this file still exists, that links are not broken. So it's their will, it's their support, it's their engagement. You know, it sounds like nothing special, but it is quite some energy to keep files functional and running online. I think there is one that maybe needs the most explanation, of the one that is not that difficult to see, and it's self-portrait. And in this case, it is a video of me trying to bring my hair in order, but the movement I make, it goes through three different browsers, and not only three different browsers, these are three different protocols. So these are three different networks that I managed to distribute myself and still come together to be one face, one hand, and all this hair that flying around. And it goes through the, so to say, normal browser. It can be Chrome, can be Firefox. You can even open it in something like Safari. And then for the central one, you have to install the Tor browser, so to go to the dark web. And then the third one, it's also another protocol, a great protocol, peer-to-peer dot protocol, and their own browser, Beaker browser. So think that this is familiar to everybody, because you need to make an effort to install the browser. In fact, it's a very little effort. Mm. And it's very legal to install all these browsers, but somehow many think that it's illegal or dangerous or not the thing to do. So I'm very happy to show also this work at the exhibition where it is all installed and people can see it, because I get a feeling that not many do make an effort and install all these different browsers to see this portrait online. Yeah, the things that non-professionals or web amateurs that they made online from the middle of 90s, I think probably it's the core of my artistic praxis and of my research, and it is also the environment that was there when I came online. You know, I supposed to be a pioneer of net art, but as a user, I was not there in the very, very beginning. So there were a lot of web pages already made. But of course, like people of my generation, they thought, oh my God, this all is ugly. This, I want to make something special. I want to make something that doesn't look like this. In the middle of the 90s, I managed to make some things that looked different. But only after I realized, when I started to teach myself, when I started to teach web design, I realized what a rich and important and generous culture was around me, and how people who were like me, how they also were killing it. By their arrogance, by their jokes, by their idea to be different. And that's, I understood it quite early. I think it's only from the 2000 I started to collect things that were disappearing at this moment online. Not only collect, but to popularize. It was like I was saying, look what is still there, but getting invisible. But step by step, I'm in the situation that it became the history and also quite a hidden one. Yeah, it's just not there anymore, but I'm still trying to uncover things, also to explain what's great about vernacular web and the elements that are supposed to be still seen as maybe some nostalgic or funny or ridiculous elements of the past, but in fact they are very powerful. The thoughts and the ideas behind them, they're very powerful and very dear to me. You know, I'm in quite often find myself in paradoxical situation, because I actually do a lot to attract attention to culture that disappears, to the past of the web, but in fact I never try to say that everything was great before. Oh, this holy times. I find it quite this nostalgia phenomena that now is really growing. So it is nostalgia that people develop about the web's past, the World Wide Web's past. It's called nostalgia. And I think it's quite also dangerous and sedating phenomenon. Also, the problem is that it's like as if there is some homogeneous past on the web that we have, and it's about some flying unicorns and star backgrounds, and I don't know. But of course, it's not like this. This work that's called False Memories, it is about the imaginary past, let's say, yeah. It is recalling Internet Explorer 6, a very powerful, at a certain moment, browser. And the browser that right at this moment is agonizing, because it will stop to exist in November. Yeah, and this version 6, it gave a crazy option to the users, to webmasters, to change the color of the scroll bar. And it was something, you know, comparable with the fights or with the wars about the frame sets. To frames or no frames, to make sites with frames or no frames. Or, and this one, do I change the color of the of the scroll bar or not? Is it professional or the opposite? It's like the kitschiest thing you can do. And yeah, so this interesting thing that now at this moment I find myself in a situation that it's yeah, we're saying goodbye to the Internet Explorer. And also at right at this moment I am in my research, I am in 2004, going through the old web pages. And at this moment, people who made their websites on GeoCities and everywhere else, they were experimenting and with the colors of the scroll bars. So they feel like they're mastering this medium, this exactly this browser. So and in this false memory, I tried to bring it really to the limit, this experimenting. And made something what theoretically would be possible at that time, but at that time computers were not so powerful for this. So these are the scripts from that time, but they work properly only today. So it is a past that in fact didn't happen, but it's theoretically it could have happened. And also, you know, I think it's quite recognizable color palette, and it's this rose gold that we know mostly from the last years from the from iPhone and from Apple products. So it's also for me the mixture of different times, of different aesthetics, and it looks like it's a past, but it never existed. I can say some words that about the treasure trove that became now the motif also for all the exhibition. And this is also dealing with the vernacular web, but with its with the later one, the one that started in 2006, so almost our times. The service still exists and it's blinger.com, and it started like a quite a modest service where you could put stamps on the photos you uploaded, and it looked like it will maybe exist for half a year or a year, but it is still here, and it's developed and has grown into such a, I would say, very friendly monster that and into the social network of people who produce different stamps, so the glittering, blinking elements, and they upload it there and they share it, and this is how the, like, there is really inside there is a universe that is like a glitter explosion, big bang glitter. But the thing is that all this locked inside there, the blinky.com has their algorithm that protects these blingers. They're all this on the checkerboard, and when if you want to use it, it's impossible to remove it. And then in 2017, I had the pleasure to work with Michael Tiger from Google's artificial intelligence and his machine learning skills and algorithms allowed to remove this checker boxes from a lot of different glittering graphics from the jewelry, that gems that I selected. And so now there is a my own treasure trove of stolen yeah, goods. But and you can see it's on purpose that they are not really perfect, but still they are now, you can use them. Yeah. And it's what I show here is the showroom of the stolen goods, and I'm grateful that